Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Sunday service. In a few minutes, we are going to start this service. Thank you for everyone that has joined so far. And we are happy for this new day that the Lord has given us today. And the title of this service is A New Life in Christ. So in a few more minutes, we're going to start. We are just waiting to see if a little bit more people is going to join. But we won't take that long before we start this service. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to this service for today's Sunday titled A New Life in Christ. We are happy because the Lord is giving us the opportunity to present ourselves once again before Him with praise and worships. And what a better way to start the week than listening about what the Lord has done and also praising and worshiping His name for everything that He is and for the new life that He has offered us through Christ. So we're going to ask our pastor, Brian Garcia, to have the opening prayer. Let's pray.
Heavenly Father, I come before You this morning, asking You for the forgiveness of my sins, that You may hear my petition that I bring before You. I give You thanks for this new week that You have given us. You have given us life and health to be able to praise Your name. I am grateful that we're able to start it on the right way, praising Your name together with our brothers and sisters. I ask for those who have not been able to join us yet, that they may be able to quickly, so that may be able to be blessed as well by the things that are prepared for this program, Lord. I ask that You be with Esequias in the direction of the program and with Lisa as well with the teaching, that Your Holy Spirit guide them, that we may be edified. This all be for Your honor and glory. Thank You for allowing us to continue this ministry. Help us and strengthen us in it, that it may be a blessing to all those who tune in, and that it may reach the souls that need it most, so that they may be edified and they may be strengthened in Your walk, Lord, and more souls can come to Your feet. Guide us through all things, and help those who need it. Perhaps in this moment, they are anxious, or they are in need of something, and they're looking for a specific word. You know each and every one situation, Lord. Please help us be able to reach them and speak the words that You want, so that they may be strengthened and they may be spared in this moment from being able to have any fallback or be anxious or be tempted by the devil. All of this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brian, for lifting us in prayer to the Lord. And like Brian said in his prayer, there are many things or many people that are going through many things in this life, physically, spiritually, emotionally. There is many things why we need a new life in Christ. And how do we get that new life? What can we do? Certainly, we cannot do anything. Everything is done by the Lord, but we have to be willing. We have to want to have a new life in Christ, and He will do the rest. So we're going to have a congregational song that is called The Cleansing Wave. If we do submerge ourselves in this wave, we will have a new life in Christ. Let's sing together. Praise the Lord for this beautiful song, although it does uses a very old-fashioned English words, which for me, especially for me, the English is my second language, and not very familiar with this manner of speak, or I don't know how to call it, and the very old language. But it's a beautiful message because it says, the cleansing stream I see, does a new life in Christ that we can imagine, that we can see from far away perhaps, but we have to do something to reach that life. And what we have to do is to take the jump and ride the wave per se. Like in the second line of the chorus says, I plunge or it cleanses me or it cleans me. So we have to do something. There is an action that we have to take. We have to choose to be submerged in that wave so we can have a new life in Christ. And praise the Lord, if he has promised that he will clean us and make us new, he will do it and he does it. We just have to use our free will to choose the Lord and to wish for a new life in Christ. And now we're gonna have the announcements by our pastor, Brian Garcia, here with us.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Once again, I'm grateful to be here with all of you in this beautiful Sunday morning, worshiping the name of the Lord. We're having our regularly scheduled 10 a.m. service on Sunday. So next week, we're planning, God willing, if everything goes well, to have an in-person service in English in our Fort Worth church. So we will be broadcasting that at 11:30 instead. On Saturdays, we have a 1 p.m. service. These times are all in central U.S. time. We'll have a 1 p.m. service on Saturday. And then we also have devotionals every day of the week in English, which are on our YouTube channel. I encourage you all to subscribe if you haven't already. We also have a Facebook page, which you're welcome to follow as well, so you can also be up to date on the activities that we are doing. As always, if there's any need or anything that we can assist with or any service that we can provide, we're here to serve you. I had a nice experience yesterday where two young men from Florida, 13 and 15 years of age, called me after the English service asking about baptism, which was great. And they're from a friend that I knew about 20 years ago, her children, and they reached out to me. So it was nice to see how this program, how this effort that we're doing is impacting people in different places. So we do that for the honor and glory of God. And we hope that this is a blessing and edifying to all those who are assisting. So we hope you continue with us and spread the word to your friends and family, those who speak English in particular, so that they may be edified as well. May the Lord bless you all.
Thank you, Brian, for those announcements. And definitely, these announcements are very encouraging to hear all the news and what the Lord is doing through this ministry. Praise be his name. And now we're going to have an opportunity to get information for the announcement. We are going to have the opportunity to get the information for tithes and offerings. Let me remind you that even though that we display the information for the local church of Fort Worth to give your tithes and offerings, if you do not belong to the congregation of Fort Worth, of course, you are always welcome to our services, but we encourage you to give your tithes and your offerings to your local church. So let's listen to this little song and let's see the information. Hallelujah, praise be the Lord. Why? Because he has given us new life in Christ. And the first of John 1:7 tell us, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So that's the wave, and that's where we have to plunge ourselves in the blood of Jesus Christ, because it's only his blood that cleanses us from all sins. Also, Romans 12:2 says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Once that we have chosen to follow Jesus Christ, once that we are given a new life in Christ, we have to be always alert and do not be conformed to this world. Otherwise, we may lose the spiritual life that we just have won through his blood. Also, in 1 Peter 1, 13 through 16, he says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Perhaps when we find a new life in Christ, we wonder, so how can I be holy? Because that's what the Lord is calling his people to be. Well, in these verses that we just read, it says very clearly that we have to be obedient. It's basically studying the Bible, learning what the Lord wants from every one of us, and obeying what we are understanding from the Bible. That's what it says, as obedient children, not conforming yourself to the former lust, and so on. So obedience is key for us to reach the holiness that the Lord is asking or demanding from every one of his children, so we can reach a new life in Christ, and we can remain in that new life as well. And let's listen to a beautiful song that is called, Yes, I Know. Perhaps you are thinking, well, that might be nice or great for people that has been always in church, or that grew up in church, or that knows the Bible back and forth, and so on and so forth, or people that always do good or try to be good. But not for me, because I am the worst person that you can think of. You don't even know me. You don't even know the worst thing that I have done. And that's true. Most of us, we don't know what each other has done, what is the worst in you. And perhaps you don't have anything good in your life. That might be also true. But even if that's the case, especially actually, if that's the case, you are a perfect candidate to have a new life in Christ. Let's listen to this song that is titled, Yes, I Know, and think about the lyrics and think about your life.
Jesus.
that's a beautiful statement and a beautiful calling also. Come, you sinners, lost and lonely. Which one are you? Are you a sinner? Are you lost or are you lonely? It doesn't matter which one are you. Jesus' blood can make you free. Why do we know this? Because he saved the worst of sinners when he saved you and me. Well, not you or me, meaning us. But if you haven't accepted Jesus Christ, this calling is for you. And he will give you strength and he will give you a new life in Christ. So this calling is not just for good people, because even good people need Jesus. Even good people, with all the goodness that we may have, just normally or regularly without Christ, our goodness doesn't compare to the purity and holiness of Christ. So this calling is for you as well, but it's also for the one that doesn't consider anything good in his life or her life. That calling is also for you to find a new life in Christ. And now we're going to have a prayer for the teaching, and we are going to have our sister Reina del Rio to pray, and after that we are going to have the Lord's prayers. Let's pray.
Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you asking forgiveness of all my sins. I thank you for this beautiful opportunity that you've given us. What a privilege, Lord, to learn about you and to be alive in your presence. I thank you, and I want to ask for this beautiful teaching, that you will prepare each and every one of us, our hearts, to receive everything that you have for us, that we would be good students, because you're the greatest teacher, Lord Jesus Christ. Your word is our sword. Your word is the one that enlightens the way. Keep us focused and give us this day blessings, and that we will be edified with all the beautiful teaching and encouraged, Lord. We need so much encouragement. We need you, Lord Jesus Christ. Give us that hope that we have in our hearts of heaven. Stay with us. Don't leave us. Don't forsake us. Help the teacher, Lisa, that she would be empowered by your Holy Spirit, that every word that it's that she would teach comes from you, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Stay with her. Don't leave her. Don't forsake her. And give us that desire to learn from your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Our Father.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And
lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Reina, and thank you, Carlos, for helping us with the prayer. And without further presentation, I'm going to have Lisa continue the teaching of hope, the anchor for the soul. So she with us.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters. Thank you so much for joining us today. May my first words to bring honor and glory to God, because this study that he has given us has impacted my life once again. This last week, I was going through some stuff at work that I was a little bit shaken. Even though COVID is on the decline here in my county, we're still having people pass away, and people that we didn't think were going to be passing away. We thought that they were going to make it, and then they don't. And that shook me a little bit. It always does when we, you know, I'm always a little bit affected when we lose patients, but this one was really tough. And so God reminded me of this Bible study that we are going through, that he is the anchor for our souls. Amen. Again, once again, I'm going to remind y'all that the chat box is there. If you have something to add or you have a question, feel free to use that chat box so that we can have your questions answered and your wisdom, your knowledge known. So we're going to start today by talking about the different types of anchors. There are five different types of anchors, and once we get a little bit more into the study today, you're going to find out why we are talking about them. So typically, ships at sea can't survive the most severe storms without the use of anchors, okay? And if you're anchorless on the sea of life, you cannot survive either. However, as long as you have an anchored life, though you may be battered and bruised, you will still be held secure. As long as you have an anchored life, you will weather the storms of life. Since there are many types of anchors, we're going to look at the five of them. So first off, we have the mushroom anchor. The mushroom anchor is mostly used for smaller vessels like rowboats and canoes, and that's the least efficient as an anchor because it doesn't have any arms. Jesus is our anchor. As the mushroom anchor is used for smaller watercraft, Jesus stabilizes us as we move through the smaller, more minor problems of everyday living. He helps us to stay steady with people who gossip and gripe, who lie or who are lazy, or who pout and are petty, who annoy us or are just nosy. Jesus anchors us when we have frustrating friends, problems with pets, as Zoe keeps trying to get pet right now, worry at works, or the list goes on. Some of the disciples who were fishermen by trade experienced the frustration of working at night, yet ended up empty-handed. Knowing this, Jesus tells them, "Put into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." But Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down my nets." Jesus then honors their obedience by filling their nets with more fish than they could ever possibly hold. Jesus proves himself to be our personal anchor for everyday trials in our life. Luke 5, 6 through 7 says, is where I got the scripture for the example of Jesus telling the disciples to cast their nets on the other side. Our next anchor is a fluke anchor, and it's pictured here. So this is very lightweight, but it has high holding power, so it'll hold secure firmly. It buries into the water's bottom, and it works best in sandy, muddy, or clay bottoms. Jesus is like this anchor because he stabilizes us with a powerful hold and a sense of peace. He is strong and steady, yet his presence brings us peace, a lightness, even in the heaviest of circumstances, whether it's a death of a loved one, a devastating diagnosis. When we are struggling with ourselves and questioning our decisions, when we have unforeseen challenges and changes, when we are doubting who we are and doubting who he is, Jesus anchors us with power and peace. Jesus sent his disciples ahead of him by boat to the other side of the lake so that he can take time alone to pray. In the middle of the night, Jesus walks towards the boat on the water. Astonished, Peter instantly wants to join Jesus on the water. And Jesus says, "Come." And he does. He steps out and begins to walk. But then his faith in the known is weakened by the fear of the unknown. As he takes his eyes off of Jesus, Peter is consumed with fear and starts to sink. And he cries out. And what does Jesus do? Jesus reaches out and rescues him. When we look at life from our limited point of view, rather than God's unlimited, infinite point of view, when doubt begins to dominate and fail, our faith begins to fail. But Jesus proves to be our personal anchor. Next up, we've got the plow anchor, and these are usually massive. They're extremely heavy, and they're often able to swivel and to turn. So this is really effective with rock, this material bottom called kelp, grass, weeds, sand, and mud. And Jesus is our anchor like this because Jesus stabilizes us when all we can see around us are problems. With its swivel capacities or capabilities, it becomes agile. So it comes in agility and adeptness to anchor us through the variety of situations, whether they be poor choices, money problems, a prodigal son or daughter, or husband or wife, painful losses, when our problems are perplexing and what we see doesn't make sense. Jesus never fails to be our anchor. Immediately after Jesus miraculously feeds 5,000 men plus women and children, he goes off alone to pray and sends his disciples by boat to Bethesda. He knows they do not understand the meaning of a miracle, but by evening, the disciples reach the middle of the lake, struggling to paddle against the wind. Jesus watches them from the shore. Then in the late hours, Jesus walks on the lake. They, becoming terrified, think that they're seeing a ghost, but Jesus quickly reassures them, climbs into the boat, and immediately the winds cease. Jesus proves himself to be our personal anchor when we don't know how to think or what to do. That example comes from Mark 6, 47 through 52. Next up, we have our claw anchor. This was originally designed for offshore gas and oil rigs, but it's most effective in rocky gravel and coral bottoms. And Jesus, like the claw anchor, he stabilizes us when we are victimized, when we experience verbal abuse, violence, or sexual abuse, claws the hearts and the body, leaving us emotionally and spiritually scarred. For the times when we feel powerless, Jesus is our powerful anchor, holding us strong and secure. While inside a boat, Jesus tells the disciples that they will all go across to the other side of the lake. Once on the water, Jesus falls into a deep sleep and is not awakened by the storm that swamps the boat. The experienced crew believes that they are sure to drown. In desperation, they cry out to Jesus. With only a few words, he calms the storm, then questions their faith. After all, hadn't he said they were going across to the other side? Didn't he imply that they would indeed make it to the other side? So Jesus proves himself as our personal anchor when the storms in life are so dangerous that the thought of death seems imminent and the memory of his promises seem to fade. Jesus is like the sea anchor. This is made of sturdy cloth, like either a giant sail or a parachute. And when lowered into the water, it creates a drag to slow the vessel down, especially when the water is deep and too great for other anchors to grab hold of the bottom. Jesus is like this as he stabilizes us when we feel like a ship flailing in the water, tossed from side to side because of a compulsive addiction or besetting sin. in the depths of our soul, he slows us down, helping us to see our continual wrong choices will wreck our relationships and shatter our dreams. Jesus anchors us when the powerful waves of personal disappointment leaves us in despair, a hopeless state in which the only recourse seems to be death, anything to end the pain. Even the most turbulent times, Jesus is there. He is our anchor in the deep. He proves himself our personal anchor when life hangs in the balance and all hope seems lost. Facing possible death, the prisoner Paul is being transported by ship to Rome to stand trial. In the midst of hurricane strength winds, the crew loses control of the ship. The winds toss the ship like a weightless cork towards the shore. In an attempt to diminish the speed, they let down the sea anchor. This is their only hope of not crashing into sandbars at a speed that would cause certain death. Jesus, when Jesus is your anchor, he can hold you secure in any storm because he has power over every storm. Now, why did we go through these five anchors? Because basically, I love the analogies. When I am going through something small, I can think back to our very first anchor, the mushroom anchor that holds things that holds me anchors when I'm facing gossiping people or when I'm facing people who lie or who are lazy or when I am starting to pout or get petty about things. I remember the mushroom anchor and I remember that Jesus is the anchor that can hold me secure. And then when I am dealing with or helping people to navigate life after abuse, whether verbal, physical, emotional, sexual abuse, I remember the claw anchor. And I remember that Jesus holds us firm in the most turbulent times and the most dangerous times in our life. He holds us secure. No matter how little or how large and dangerous our problems are, Jesus holds us fast and secure. Sometimes we place our hope in things that fail. And that is where the Bible study is leading us today. There are causes for misplaced hope to fail. Have you ever had your hope fail? You can't understand why. You try to figure it out. You thought you had enough hope plus a boat full of faith. But since the Bible says hope is the anchor for the soul, what causes an anchor to fail? The problem could be that the anchor is the wrong type for the water bottom, or the wrong size, or the wrong weight, or made of the wrong substance, or the wrong technique could have been applied. Meaning too little, too much, too weak, so that the holding power of the anchor is severely compromised. Many anchors that people rely on fail, causing hope to fail. In life, having the right anchor or hope with the right road or faith is just as crucial as having crucial for the largest open ocean liner as for the smallest boat. We have all placed our confidence in something or someone that did not hold or that broke under pressure. So our unreliable anchors, Matthew 7:26 through 27 says, Everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the wind blew and beat against that house, and it fell with such a great crash. The pain of placing our hope in a person or in a position or fill in the blank, only to discover that we've been terribly deceived. And what makes the deception worse is the fact that it was a self-deception. Typically, someone warned us, yet we failed to pay attention. Temporary anchors like possessions, popularity, power, or position were never designed to be our anchors for life. For we're told, fix our eyes not on what is seen, but is on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Unreliable anchor of politics. We see this now. We've seen this in the past. The result is loss of hope when political systems crumble. Psalms 9:15, the nations have fallen into the pit they have dug. Their feet are caught in the net they have hidden. Our unreliable anchor of economics results in loss of hope when resources of the economy weaken. Ecclesiastes 7:14, when times are good, be happy. But when times are bad, consider God has made the one as well as the other. Therefore, a man cannot discover anything about his future. What about society? Our unreliable anchor of society results in a loss of hope when society rejects God's moral standard. The moral of society's morals change with the wind. With one presidency, they think one thing. With the other presidency, they say something else. It's an ongoing cycle. Society will fail as an anchor. Judges 17:6 says, in those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as they saw fit. Why? Because society changes with the wind. Law is our unreliable anchor. Human law results in a loss of hope when the legal system fails. Psalms 58:1 and 2 says, do you rulers indeed speak justly? Do you judge uprightly among men? No, in your heart you devise injustice, and your hands mete out violence on the earth. If we put our hope in the law, eventually our legal system will fail. What about our vocation or our careers? If we put our hope in our vocation or careers, this will inevitably result in the loss of hope when the work is not meaningful. Ecclesiastes 4:8. There was a man all alone. He had neither son nor brother. There was no end to his toil, yet his eyes were not content with his wealth. For whom am I toiling, he asked, and why am I depriving myself of enjoyment? This too is meaningless, a miserable business. What about our health? Are we anchored in our health? I'm healthy. I don't have any problems. My blood pressure is fine. My diabetes, I don't have. Health is a very unreliable anchor, and it will result in a loss of hope when our body deteriorates. Psalms 38:7 says, my back is fit, or for my loins are full of inflammation, and there is no soundness in my flesh. Basically, he's got a lot of pain, and there is no health in his body. What about money? Anchoring in money results in a loss of hope when circumstances cause a monetary loss. Proverbs 27:24. Riches do not endure forever, and a crown is not secure for all generation. Money comes and money goes. It cannot be our reliable anchor. What about marriage? an unreliable anchor of marriage results in a loss of hope when a spouse is not faithful or a spouse passes away. Malachi 2:14, the Lord is acting as the witness between you and the wife of your youth because you have broken faith with her, though she is your partner, the wife of your marriage covenant. I see this time and time again. When marriage is our anchor, we place all of our hope in our spouse and we allow our spouse to become an anchor for us. Spouses are wonderful when they are pointing us to Christ and constantly reminding us to put our anchor in Christ. But what if that doesn't happen? We become shattered. We become bitter. We question our faith and doubt sink in because more often than not, we put our anchor into our marriage. Amen. Friendships can be an unreliable anchor. Psalms 41:9, even when my close friend whom I trusted, he who shared my bread has lifted up his heel against me. When our friends betray our confidence, we lose our hope. What about our children? If we anchor in our children, we'll lose hope when children bring great pain upon their parents. Proverbs 17:25 and Matthew 10:21. A foolish son brings grief to his father and bitterness to the one who bore him. Brothers will betray brother to death and father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. Our children cannot be an anchor for us. What about religion? Anchoring our hope in religion results in a loss of hope when we glory in our good deeds rather than God's gift of grace. Matthew 6:1-5. Take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds before men to be seen by them. Otherwise, you have no reward from your Father in heaven. And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. My brothers and sisters, as wonderful as religion can be, we cannot put our anchor in our good works, in our good deeds, or in our religious leaders because they will inevitably fail us in one sense or another. Instead, putting our anchor in Christ Jesus, our relationship with Christ, the anchor in Him is what is going to sustain us. Our religion, our church as a whole, the people in our church, they will fail us at some point or another. But we will not be shaken if our anchor is in Christ. Amen. Where is our hope when it doesn't happen? There are three types of God's will. I'm going to go through this quickly because time is running. In 1912, the most magnificent ship ever built set sail on its maiden voyage, heralded to the world as unsinkable. How then could the Titanic sink? A total of 1,573 went to their watery graves because the owner of the shipping line failed to provide the needed lifeboats. He went to sail a transatlantic record for speed. The typical question people ask is, why would God allow such a catastrophe? Typically, God gets the blame, even though the ship received warning after warning about icebergs. But where is God when God allows bad things to happen? Can you have absolute hope that God's will is going to prevail? What happens when your hope, whatever it is that you're hoping for, doesn't happen. Some people get angry at God. Others get angry with the church. Others yet again get angry with life when their expectations are not fulfilled, when it doesn't happen. What do we need to know about the will of God? There are three types, and I'm just going to introduce them, and next week we're going to go into them, because in knowing the will of God and the three types of will of God, hope becomes tangible. Hope becomes real, and we can put it into practice. So there is God's perfect will, where God has an ideal plan, and the plan is pleasing and good. Then God has a permissive will. God permits each person to exercise free will in opposition of his perfect will. God created people not as robots with no ability to choose, but as humans with the ability to choose independently of God. And then God's prevailing will. God's plans cannot be thwarted. God's ultimate purposes are achieved because he is sovereign. There are many plans in man's heart. Nevertheless, the Lord's counsel, that will stand. Proverbs 19:21. God's prevailing will is to grant full forgiveness and a home in heaven to all who repent of their sins and trust in Jesus Christ as their Lord and as their Savior. In our painful circumstances, since God ordains marriage and hates divorce, I'm believing God for the restoration of my marriage. He has to answer my prayers to reunite my family. God indeed has his perfect will. However, he also gives people free will by allowing each of us to go against his perfect will. The hope that you are given by God is not based on other people's circumstances. Your certain hope, that is, regardless of the choices of other people make and regardless of the severity of the storms in your life, if you choose to do his will, he will work out his purposes for you and ultimately give you that peace that passes all understanding. And here is where I will leave you. Philippians 4, 6 and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Praise God, my brothers and sisters, for this next part of hope, our anchor for our soul. I'm going to ask our brother Carlos Del Rio to give us the final prayer, our closing prayer, and the final blessing.
Amen. Amen. Let's all pray. Heavenly Father, I come before you asking forgiveness of my sins. Oh, we thank you for this English ministry. What a great anchor it is to our souls. Allow us to understand the importance that it is to our spiritual life. Let's all pray that many will join, young and old, as the anchor is a tool that you are providing us to be blessed. And it's our only hope, as we learned today. Oh, Father, give us that wisdom that we need, especially to start this new week that you have given us, this hope of heaven, this hope in you that only it is. Let's not put our hope on anything that we are surrounded by, people, health, our jobs, anything, because all that will go away in a matter of a minute, as we all know. So let us understand, and we thank Lisa and especially Esequias, they're both, and everyone that have joined us to continue this path that you are given us. And let's hold on to that anchor that we learned, that we have learned throughout the three lessons that Lisa has provided to us. But now we ask that the blessed love of God, the grace and peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the companion and communion of the Holy Spirit, our great counselor, be with all of his children now and forever. Amen. A blessed week to all.
Amen.
God bless.
God bless you. Thank you once again, everybody, for Amen. Joining us for our English service the first day of the week. I pray that your week is a blessing. You remember your anchor is in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, everyone.